everybody, and welcome to the epic, awesome show, anime podcast number
74!
Oh yeah. So in this week, unfortunately, this is the week to end
this season of anime.
Yeah, thank you. This season's ending, thank you. For some
You're
reason,
welcome.
I was blanking out on that. And I don't
That's normal. You're welcome.
I'm gonna smack you for that.
Why?
For saying that's normal for me to just blank out and stuff.
But it's true.
It may be true. But still, I will smack you anyways because I like to smack you. You know you like it.
Maybe a little bit.
Okay, it's getting very awkward very fast.
So, oh, come on. We've done more awkward.
Actually, yeah, we probably have in the past.
Minecraft.
Yeah, we've done it more awkward. Okay, so so in the past and everything else, not in the past, right now, it's in the future, in the present. We'll be in the future when you're listening to this.
Aha!
I just feel like I just went metaphysical. I don't know why, but yeah. So, back on track again.
Yes.
We're going to talk about some of our favorites from this season. Some of our favorite animes from this season. Later on, we are going to be doing a... We are going to be doing our top 10 favorite animes and our top 10 most disappointed animes in a future thing. So, you're gonna be able to hear us a little bit... we're going to work on that a little bit later. So... Yay.
Just be prepared.
Yeah. So we're going to be doing our favorites and our worst ones. So we're going to talk a little bit about our favorites. We're not going to number it, whether it's one of our personal favorites. I mean, granted, by now you know which animes we actually are going to like. So.
Oh, yeah.
So one of the animes, would you like to start? Because I know there's one anime that I know you really want to say that you love.
Yes, I have to say it. It's Nisekoi.
Yes.
Nisekoi, ever since the first episode, has caught my attention, and really, it feels like season two is better ran than season one.
Yeah.
And I think because we already have the establishment of the characters, we now just get to see the more expansive world of these characters, and what their thought process are, and how their feelings are towards one another. And the antics they get into, and it's amazing. I love it.
I would say, my favorite things about Nisekoi is that the antics, the absolute antics of what the guy gets thrown into so many different times.
The bird.
Like, the bird is one of the biggest examples. Like, it's the most hilarious examples where he's trying to say that, and she is evil. That's all I'm going to say.
She is
pure evil, but hilarious at the same time. Because it's like, I would say if it was any other, like, the way her character is done, if it was done any other way, she would not be a very likable character.
Nope. And because she is a very conniving character, it plays really well to how she's been since season one, especially the Romeo and Juliet episode. I kind of got a hint of that.
Yeah.
And then in this, it's just, it escalates.
Oh, it just goes somewhere. I don't know where, but it goes somewhere. I mean, granted, this doesn't really have a plot to it. I mean, Nisekoi is not an anime that I would say has a very expansive plot. Yeah.
It's not the next Fullmetal Alchemist.
No.
But it's a very fun anime.
Oh, it's very fun. But if you really want a series that's really good plot-based and very good... The plot's, I would say, is probably about, you know, kind of generic, whatever. We've seen it a million times where the hero, the weakest guy, all of a sudden becomes the hero. We've seen that plot a million times. But that is... is it wrong to pick up girls in a dungeon? I absolutely love this series. Especially because seeing from the first episode all the way to episode 13 for the final episode. And you see this character the main character just grow.
And he grows at a radical rate. I have not seen the last 4 episodes, but I do plan on trying to catch up very quickly, because I really like Is It Wrong to Try to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon. It's a very funny show, and I really like the main characters.
Oh, yeah, definitely. It's definitely one of those series that it's definitely a great way that I'm glad that Sentai has gotten a hold of it, which it doesn't mean that they're going to dub it. I don't know yet.
I'm not sure either. It would be nice to have a dub for it.
Because, I mean, as of right now with Sentai's kind of starting to get on the dub bandwagon. I'm noticing that a lot more now.
Not just the dub bandwagon, but the Toonami bandwagon as well.
Yeah, because another show that's going on Toonami is Parasite. That has just been announced that Parasite is going to be on Toonami. And it's just like, wow, they're going to have 2 shows on Toonami. And then it's Funimation show. And actually, it's going to be interesting because it's going to have a very weird mix to it. Because a lot of the shows that are on there right now, like Sword Art Online 2, Kill la Kill, are not Funimation. They are Bang Zoom.
Yeah, I mean, we have the few Funimation shows, and we also have the few Bang Zoom shows. And then soon we're going to have the couple of Sentai shows. And it's like, oh my god, we have variety again.
Yeah, which is really nice to see, you know, various. Because before it was just pretty much, it was a Bang Zoom show versus all of Funimation. Or a little bit of Viz put in there. So it's like here and there, just like, But now you're getting various dubbing companies, Funimation, I think, will still have the majority of the shows on there.
Yeah, but at least Sentai is starting to kind of creep its way into there.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, is that, you know, they're coming around with really good dubs. I mean, they released another video for No Game No Life as well.
Oh my god, I've actually seen the other two, and I'm watching these clips, I'm like, oh my god, this is really good.
Yeah, and for Sentai, for them to be this spot on is, I hate to say it, but it's very rare to see them this spot on, because I've watched a couple of their stuff, and even in Clannad Afterstory, some of the characters there are very spotty. Like, some of them, just like, it's like, like, Clannad Afterstory is a very good dub all around, but I mean, it's just, it's got spots where it's very hit and miss.
Hmm.
And same thing with, like, there's one character, the sister character in Clannad Afterstory, where sister. I did not like her, it's like the main character's friend's sister.
Oh.
Yeah, the person they got to dub her, I just didn't like I don't know if it was just the voice or it was just, it just didn't fit well.
I thought the acting was fine for
The acting was fine. It's just
her voice is a little grating at times.
Yeah, that's the thing right there. It's very, very, very grating. But to get somebody that's spot on with the thing, and it might actually be better than the Japanese. Yeah, I just said it. I think it might be better than the Japanese. Granted, we still gotta see it. We still gotta get it done. We still just... I think this is gonna be Sentai's turnaround point, because... Which might be a good thing, too, to see that Sentai's might start getting more stuff out and may wind up turning around being another Funimation, where they're, all of a sudden they're just dubbing everything.
Yeah, hopefully Sentai will... as to pick up, and maybe they can, in their own way, revive ADV.
Yeah. I mean, ADV, that would be great to see them come out with, to re-release another ADV show that totally should get a re-release, and somebody should totally pick it up.
Are you talking about that one again?
Generator Gall, yes, I am talking about Generator Gall. I absolutely love Generator Gall, and it should get a re-release.
Why am I picturing you just cuddling?
Why am I even doing that? I don't know why. That was stupid. Ay, ay, ay. Oh, for some reason, I'm randomly, like, my microphone's on keyboard, and it's, like, I moved it just a little bit, and then all of a sudden it went, like, 4, enter. It's like, what? No!
No, don't do it!
Yeah. Oops.
Not 4, enter!
Oh, shut up. No, but, it's gonna be very interesting. I'd love to see somebody pick it up. I mean, Funimation, please pick it up. Somebody pick it up. Generator Gall is definitely a good series. Everybody should watch it. And you can watch it on YouTube, so... It is available to watch. I watched it firstly on YouTube, and it's a great series, 12 episodes. Yeah, I think I hound on that series though. Not a lot, but a little.
Just enough for me to be like, okay, Zane, we get the point.
Yes. Yes, you do. So, so with some of the other series that are ending this week, with a bunch of series coming out, and, you know, something cool happened at Anime Expo this year, I would say is probably one of the coolest things that they think they've ever done.
Which is?
Okay, so Bang Zoom has done something, you know, has done some really cool stuff with AX Idol.
And Open Auditions.
Open Auditions, which, granted, it's been doing going on, but they've been doing a lot more stuff because they did a... an actual dubbing session. It was kind of like an odd thing, which was hearing about it with I don't know if they're doing it all every day for I don't know if it's something that Bangzoom's doing every day with various different actors, but one of the actors that they used for that was Erica Harlatcher for Kill la Kill. She was also in, I'm trying to think here, Adonia Zero.
Okay.
I hope I'm pronouncing that right, but sorry about that.
Whew. It's okay.
Yeah, and where basically she did some basically wound up doing some dubbing in front of people, and you kind of get to see the thing of how it's done. Granted, this is something that was done at their booth.
Okay.
So, it was something that was really cool. Something that, like, in case you couldn't make it to their, you know, inside the voice actor studio. Well, I stopped doing that. I'm going to kill something here. In case you couldn't make it to their inside the voice actor studio, that's something that would be really fun and really exciting to see somebody, you know, you get to actually see a professional do their job and, you know, in front of people. And really get to see what it's like.
Oh, yeah.
And that's just something that's really cool, really great. Definitely some of the stuff that she's done she's been in a few things now. Kill la Kill, one of the biggest ones she was in was Toradora. So, yeah, and Scotty knows how good that was.
I love Toradora.
I know you love Toradora. Now put it down.
I don't have it out with me.
Sure you don't. I bet you carry it with you at all times.
Well, actually, I'm not. I'm gonna stop where I'm with that because I'm gonna leave it to the listener's imagination.
I don't want to leave it to listener's imagination. So that was one of the stuff that was going on with Anime Expo this year. That, you know, there's just a ton of stuff. Some of the other stuff that they did at Anime Expo this year is they released a. The names of the people who are going to be in Sailor Moon S.
Ah, yes. Let me.
Which include Erica Mendez and Christine Marie Cabanos.
There you go.
I think I got the name right.
Yes.
Because I've seen that name a lot.
For what oh, yeah. About. In oh, fact, she's going to be at KimoraCon.
Yeah, it's really cool. It is really cool to see, you know, various, sorry, I'm trying to get to there right now. So don't mind me, just bear with me here. Okay, here we go. Here we are. So we have Erica Mendez as Sailor Uranus. Uranus. Okay, I'm sorry, that was bad, but I don't care. Lauren Londa as Sailor Neptune. Christine Marie Cabanos as Sailor Saturn, and Keith Silverstein as Professor Tome. Now, Keith Silverstein has actually was in Kill la Kill as well.
Okay.
I believe he was there. I don't quote me on that yet.
Quoting because, you.
Oh, shut up. Well, I smack you.
I'm sorry.
No, you're not sorry.
Only on Tuesdays.
Was I wrong? I was wrong. My bad. He was in Maggie, The Kingdom of Magic. He's been in a ton of stuff. So, Durarara, Eureka 7, Kogias. So, he's been in a ton of stuff. Bleach. So he's been in a ton of stuff. So, I was wondering why in the world his name sound familiar.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I can't find the article. But that's because it's the, page right now is running very slowly.
Yeah, it's one of those things. Yeah, so in case you're wondering, Erica Mendez is the leading, if you don't know who she sounds like and all that stuff, she is the leading character of Kill la Kill, and the character of, oh my goodness, Rukia Kuchi. So yeah, and then Christine Marie Cabanos is her friend on that one. Is the hilarious character. The character that everyone likes.
Yeah.
Because she's so funny.
And so random.
Very, very, very random. But I'm kind of excited to see, you know, where you see all these actors coming in for... I was able to watch a little bit of the Sailor Moon R dub.
Yeah.
When they did the Moonlit Party for it, and I'm not at all embarrassed to say I went to the Moonlit Party.
Were you able to, did you dress up like a Sailor Scout?
No.
Dude, I would have totally dressed up as a Sailor Scout and sent in pictures.
And then I would have had to punch you.
Why?
Because there's certain things I just wouldn't be able to unsee. Certain things, man. Certain things. I just don't want those images in my head.
Come on, be like...
images.
Like, I'm Sailor Moon.
Oh. Oh, my God. I hate you. I really hate you right now. You do realize that, right?
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But no, it's really cool to see that the Sailor Moon R dub is really good. Sailor Moon S dub is just going to be just as good. And it's going to be spot on. If anybody out there was wondering, yo, this is not going to be as good as the original, trust me. This is going to be better than the original, mm-hmm. because it's not going to have a what is it? The thing I was talking about here. It's not going to have different voice actors that the original had.
Or random weird localization censorship.
The other one didn't have a lot of censorship, like the weird censorship, I don't think. I mean, granted, I believe... Uranus and Neptune in the original, I believe, were cousins in the original.
Yes.
Localization instead of actually being, like, partners.
Yeah, lesbian lovers.
Yeah, so, yeah. Needless to say, they're changing that up, but... So, it's definitely going to be interesting. It's going to be very, very interesting.
Oh, yeah.
So... Whether, you know, you're going to be really liking it or not, I don't know. Hey, but you got the 200 episodes. I mean, they're coming out with it very quickly, though.
Oh, yeah.
Right now, I'm actually kind of surprised because last year, it was about this time last year, is when they started doing when they released Crystal. And they released the actual, the dub last year, right?
I believe so, yeah. It was a dub of Crystal that was released last year, and now we're getting...
No, it wasn't the dub of Crystal. It wasn't released last year.
Oh, what?
The dub of Crystal, I think, got released this year.
Oh, this year?
Yeah. Last year was the release of Sailor Moon itself.
Okay. It's just been... that. Yeah, it's just... Everything's just coming out so quickly for Sailor Moon, and it's dubs.
Yeah. But, I mean, it totally makes sense that it's, you know, coming out so quickly, because it's already been done, and really, you just have to localize... Not really localize it, but get the dub ready to go, and... just get it done.
Yeah.
So it's going to be very interesting. Right now they've released the second half of Sailor Moon's first season of Sailor Moon R in February. I don't know when they're going to be... Oh, okay, they were going to be releasing the... Yeah, they've already released the first set of R on July 14th. That's when they're releasing that.
Wow. So,
because they released the first season, the second part, half of the first season in February. So, granted, I'm wondering, though, is this going to be get on Toonami, though?
I don't think it will, personally. I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But I just don't see the demographic for it, for Sailor Moon to be on Toonami.
True.
But it could be possible, though. Nothing is impossible, but it's just, I don't see it.
Yeah, because, I mean, it's kind of more of a little kiddish anime, but not really. It's a very weird,
taste.
Because it's like, it's, the dick dub was definitely a little kid, but, I mean, even going through and watching the original dub, and I gotta go through the whole original dub, this new dub.
I was going to say, I thought the original dub with the dick dub.
Not the dick dub. No, I'm talking about the Viz dub. My bad. My bad on that one. I'm rambling here, but I'm going to stop from rambling and get on to the point. And that to see, you know, how much of a little kid aspect it does have versus an adult aspect. Because, well, it is anime after all.
Yeah, that's true.
And granted, the adult aspect of Sailor Moon, it's mostly a little... girlish?
It's tame.
Yeah, it's tame, but I mean, it's one of their two. So, alright, I'm just going through some stuff real quickly here.
Okay.
Just bear with me. Some of the other stuff, so, alright. So now Sentai Filmworks has actually required more stuff as well.
Yes. In fact, how many articles for that is there? Two?
I don't know how many articles there is there, but they acquired Yushio and Tora, Gate, School Live, Waka Girl, and Ahura X Machinagun Anime. So these are the summer 2015 titles, and they announced this at Anime Expo. So... yeah, another thing at Anime Expo this year that would have been, like, great to see.
Some announcements.
Yeah. It would have been kind of good to see, you know, and just seeing that they're coming out with some... because, I mean, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 different series from the summer.
Oh, yeah.
And normally, Sentai doesn't actually announce their stuff until... actually, they announce some stuff... for it, but some of the other stuff they wait on.
Yeah, and also too, Sentai has announced that it has acquired Legend of the Galactic Heroes and Higurashi When They Cry.
Yeah.
When They Cry had a very rough run.
Yeah.
Because it originally premiered as a Genion title, Genion went out of business, Funimation picked it up, Funimation dropped the license for it.
Really?
Yes.
That's weird.
Well, Funimation dropped the license for a lot of shows. And Higurashi was one of the victims. And Sentai picked it up. I'm really hoping Sentai redubs the show.
Yeah.
Because the original dub was just so terrible. It was, like, as bad as Animax dubs.
I see. So that's weird that they dropped the show, though.
Well, it didn't exactly drop the show, but they let the license expire.
Yeah.
So that's what I mean by dropping the show, is that they don't even try to pick it back up.
Yeah. But, I mean, it's still kind of weird that they did that. But so...
they even did it for The Familiar of Zero, which is now picked up by Sentai.
Yeah. So it looks like it's going to be getting a... okay, so Niz actually did release When They Cry in North America on Blu-ray disc in 2012. So, Whether or not they're going to do a dub on it, I don't know whether they're going to redub it or not. I mean, it wouldn't be the first time they redub something, because they just did, they just announced that they were going to do the redub of the,
You're talking about Sentai, right?
Yeah, I'm talking about Sentai. The redub of
Vampire Hunter D.
Thank you. Of that series, so it wouldn't be a shock.
Which, speaking of that, Vampire Hunter D is getting a new anime series.
Okay, that's a lot there. Dang. Okay,
Actually, this is going to be, from my experience, it's actually a joint effort between Japan and North America.
Okay.
Because Vampire Hunter D is better known in America than it is in Japan. Let's see, here we go. California-based production studio United Pictures told ANN that is unveiling plans for the new CG anime series based on the long-running novel Vampire Hunter D. The company is co-producing this series with CGI Japanese animation studio Digital Frontier, who's done Resident Evil Degeneration, Tekken Blood Vengeance, and Mighty No. 9.
Yeah.
Unified Pictures producer Scott McLean said the company is looking to bring the series to television. I've been a fan of Vampire Hunter D since I was a teenager, he said. I'm overjoyed to being part of creating a new chapter for a story I greatly admire. And when I was younger, I've watched the second one, which is Bloodlust.
Mm-hmm.
And I've watched the original film, the original OVA. And to me, the original OVA from like the 1980s is so much better from the one from 2000s.
Yeah.
But the hear that this is getting a resurrection, hence the name Vampire Hunter D Resurrection. To hear that this is getting resurrected, brought back, it actually makes me kind of glad to hear that this is getting brought back to life again after so many years and so many attempts.
Yeah.
I'm hoping that this will be the definitive version of the story.
I don't know. I mean, it's going to... I think it's probably going to depend on... I've never seen a Vampire Hunter D anime. I've actually never seen the series at all.
It was just the two OVAs. I didn't like Bloodlust very much. Bloodlust was actually made for American audiences. Even the animation style very much shows that.
Mm-hmm.
And the original was made before that, and it was just pure gore everywhere. It was a gore fest of an anime. But basically, the story is about this like half vampire who goes around killing other vampire as that's his job. And he has a talking hand.
Yeah.
Yeah, he has a talking hand that helps him on his journey, keeps him company, and the hand does not stop talking.
Hmm. Interesting.
Yes. Which direction they're going to go with exactly for this remake, I don't know. But hopefully we'll be hearing more information about it soon.
Yeah. I would say we're going to hear more about it soon. I mean, it's not like they're going to just, like, drop it all together and not going to be other ones as well. So mm-hmm. Some of the other ones that Funimation are getting their hands on this year, too. So talking about licensed anime, basically going through funny specials. We'll call them funny specials for right now.
Okay.
This new season, Snow White and the Red Hare is going to be done by Funny. Rampo Kitan, Game of the Place, Gangsta, Seiyu's Life, Bikini Warriors, Prison School, Hetalia the World Twinkle, Aquarium Logos, yeah, I know. Sky Wizards Academy, Juno Romantica 3, Overlord, Castletown Dandelion, and Shimoneta, A Boring World Where the Concept of Dirty Jokes Doesn't Exist. What, the world? That sounds hilarious.
The front picture for that?
Yeah.
is of a naked girl wearing underwear on her head.
What?
I'm not even joking.
I'm looking at the picture right now, and I'm going like, what? That sounds hilarious.
It is.
Granted, this is the reasons what got us into another really good series. That was, Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon?
Oh, yeah, because it just sounded ridiculous.
Oh, it sounded very, very ridiculous. And this sounds so ridiculous, too. That actually sounds like it could actually be really funny.
Oh, yeah. Of all the animes, though, that they have announced, mm-hmm. I'm really looking forward to, Gangsta, and, A Boring World where the concept of dirty jokes doesn't exist. Those are, like, the... Oh, and Say You, those are the top three shows I'm really looking forward to.
Yeah.
From Funimation, I'm not counting Dragon Ball Super yet, because they haven't officially announced it. And when they do, that would be my number one choice.
Yeah, but I mean, Dragon Ball Super, I think, is definitely going to go into... I'd be surprised if it wasn't being streamed on Funimation, but because it's the series itself, I think that series also was streamed... Kai is also streamed on Crunchyroll as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it'll be both on Crunchyroll and the other one as well. So I think it's...
I hope so.
So it's going to be very interesting. Bikini Warriors sounds stupid.
Oh, yeah. Is that something I'm looking forward to?
That's going to be a fan service anime just by looking at it. And just looking at the actual title, you can definitely tell it's going to be a fan service anime.
Oh, yeah.
Aquarian Logos might actually be really good. Hetalia the World Twinkle, of course it's Hetalia. Why not?
Exactly, it's Hetalia.
Hetalia! Gangsta looks like it's going to be fun. Snow White and the Red Hair actually looks decent. It looks interesting.
It does, I just don't know enough about it to make any judgment.
Yeah, I mean, there's some things that are just like, Private Academy probably will not touch that one, because it looks like it's going to go into another needless thing of
being... It's ridiculous.
Yeah, it's going to be probably one of those things. It's so ridiculous that it's stupid. There's just so many different things. Sky Wizards actually looks like it's actually going to be pretty decent. So I'm definitely looking forward to that one. Oh my goodness. I feel like you have Funimation... And then you have like Sentai being like, oh, we got 5, and then you got Funimation going, haha, cute.
We have 13.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like...
And more.
I mean, right now, I think that's all that's been announced so far.
Yes, and they said there's going to be, let's see, Funimation also confirmed that it will continue streaming One Piece, Fairy Tail, Ninja Slayer... Ultimate Otaku Teacher, and Heroic Legend of Arslan.
Well,
the company said it is streaming 20 titles this season, leaving 2 more to be announced.
Okay. So I think it's also including... I think that might be also including the stuff that they're also streaming as well.
Yeah.
From what it sounds like. So.
Yeah, from last season and this season, plus 2 more titles.
So I think one of those 2 titles is definitely going to be Super.
I'm thinking one of those 2 titles is indeed Dragon Ball Super.
Because I would be surprised, I would be shocked...
If it wasn't.
Yeah, exactly, because it'd be like going like, what? No? Okay, that was completely taken by surprise, because next fall is going to be the continuation of another series that they're doing this year.
Oh?
Next fall they're going to be doing it's the second season of that vampire one they were doing.
The vampire one they were doing?
Yeah, I can't think of the name of the vampire series. Oh my goodness.
I don't know.
I'm looking at it. It's the guy with the sword. Yeah, they have the demons to help them.
The succubus?
No. To where the humans are fighting the vampires.
Oh, Seraph of the End.
Thank you. The second season of that's going to be in the fall. So...
That has to be picked up.
So that's going to be definitely an automatic Funimation right there. So Funny's got that already. So with Funimation having so much new stuff and then dubbing new stuff, they're busy. That's all I'm going to say. They're just ridiculously busy. I mean, Funimation I think has gotten to the point now,
even partnering up with Universal, they've become the point where they could pretty much do whatever they want.
It's a madhouse.
Pretty much. Aha,
I get it?
Yeah, I get it. Aha! Uh-huh. Aha! Also, I don't know when the new Little Witch Academia is going to be coming out, too.
Anime Expo?
Oh, I know it's coming out at Anime Expo.
Oh, you mean we're being streamed on Crunchyroll?
Yes, that's what I'm talking about right there.
Oh, I have no clue.
Unfortunately, nothing's been released on that yet, which, once that comes out on Crunchyroll, I'm definitely watching it because, well, anybody who knows anything at this point in time, I really, really, really do like Trigger's style.
As for me, it's a little bit of a hit and miss, but I did really like Little Witch Academia. I thought it was a very cute and a very interesting OVA.
Yeah.
And I was hoping for more, too, and finally we're getting more.
Yeah, but I mean, it's some of those things where they're kind of doing more OVA style instead of, like, episode by episode by episode. So it's going to have that nice, clean look to it.
Well, I don't know if clean is the correct word, but yeah.
It's going to have a nice, crisp, dirty, clean look.
There you go, a dirty, clean look. That's a little
that's
better.
That's the thing I always use for them, is that they're dirty, clean. It's a very, very weird style. It's a dirty, clean style, but I love their style. I have to admit, I really, really do like their style. I guess with looking at different animes, you know, and, like, various different styles by various companies, you can definitely tell the difference.
One anime I'm very surprised the Senta did not pick up, now that I'm looking through the site right now?
Yeah.
Charlotte.
Really? Why are you surprised they didn't pick that up?
Because they picked up, because ADV originally did Canon and Air before ADV went out of business.
Yeah.
And then we had the subsidiary, which is Sentai, which dubbed Clannad.
I thought they did pick Clannad it up.
No, Funimation picked it up. Oh. They rescue licensed them.
Okay, Charlotte, they actually picked that up. For some reason, I thought Charlotte was picked up by Sentai. I don't know why I thought that.
Oh, no. Charlotte was not picked up by anyone yet, I mean.
Oh, okay. Oh,
But, you know, Funimation rescue licensed Air and Canon.
Yeah.
But Sentai did Clannad and Angel Beats.
Yeah.
Which are all kind of done by the same group of people.
Yeah, because I know Clannad is not actually a Clannad, the Clannad After Story dub. That is that actually a Sentai dub, or is that actually an ADV dub, though?
It's Sentai.
Is it actually a Sentai dub?
Yes.
Okay, because I wasn't sure when, if it was made under the name of Sentai, or if it was made under a different...
Yes, it was dubbed under the name of Sentai, a.k.a. Section 23.
Yeah, okay. Because I wasn't 100% sure on that, if it was like an ADV special... Then it kicked over to Sentai. When Sentai picked it up, that's the reason why it's like, I don't want to say, like, oh, this dub was something that Sentai did, and then all of a sudden it not being a Sentai dub, because it's like saying, like, Cowboy Bebop is a Funimation dub when it's not.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, with Sentai and ADV is that because they're part of the same company anyways,
yeah,
they actually have 99.9% of the same voice actors.
Well, yeah, I mean, they're the same area, same everything, pretty much.
Which is why I kind of do say, you know, Sentai / ADV because of that reason, because it's part of the same company.
Well, yeah, but then you have different people, though, too, actually doing the directing, though. That's the...
Yeah.
I think that would be the big difference there. So,
yeah, probably.
So, let's see, what else do we have left to talk about here? Okay, so actually, this is something that's really interesting as well. Now, if you guys are really a big people, or, like, a lot of people are, that like the old Gundams, Right Stuff and Sunrise to release the original Gundam TV anime on Blu-ray disc. So this includes Zeta Gundam, Gundam ZZ, Victory Gundam, After War Gundam X, and Turna Gundam film collection. So if you guys are really big into the Gundam series, I mean, granted, some of these Gundams I would love to see get a Blu-ray disc release would be like Gundam Wing. Would be one I would love to see get a re-release.
Yeah, I like to see some of those older shows get brought back in. Which one was it with the tournament?
G Gundam?
Yeah.
I did.
G Gundam was actually my personal favorite one because for me it felt like, okay, the whole giant tournament thing, I kind of like the idea of that. Yeah.
Unfortunately, I did not like G Gundam.
You did it?
No. It's not one of my favorites. I did not watch a lot of it, but I still, it's not one of the ones that just, like, stick in my mind and be, like, one of the greats.
Ah. There was one Gundam I did see, though. It was, I can't remember. I think it was, like, there's so many Gundams. I might need help with this one, okay?
Okay.
It was, like, Gundam 0088 or something like that? Or 0080?
Oh, you're talking about the Gundam 00?
It was an older one.
Oh, okay, so I don't know.
I don't know either, but I remember Adult Swim was showing, I think, the first three episodes only.
Yeah.
Because they were just showing, like, this big fight between, like, the two mechs, and the main character dies, supposedly. You don't see his death on screen, really, but you see, like, his mech destroyed, and this little boy's like, no!
Yeah.
And then they repeat the same episodes over and over, and I was like, you know what? I think I'm done watching the show now.
Yeah.
You're pulling a Fooly Cooly. Do not pull a Fooly Cooly.
And that's actually something I never watched either, so.
You're killing me, Smalls.
Oh, hush. So something really cool, too, is that Funimation announced at Anime Expo on basically today, on Friday, or yesterday, whatever you want to call it. Today's tomorrow, whatever. That has the rights to the unaired free Eternal Summer episode. The company will release the original video anime episode next year, and it will offer a discount to those who buy the premium edition of the television series from the Funimation.com by September 29th. The premium edition will come with contents of the free Eternal Summer limited edition plus a colorful art book, 7 art cards, a sports towel, and a Watobi decal, and a Sazumaka decal, and a collector's box. The premium edition retails from about $119. But Funimation is selling the edition for $90.
Wow.
So, yeah. So it's coming up. Those who order the premium edition of the Funimation.com will be entered into a raffle to win a 1/8 scale figure of Haruku Nasa.
Are you going to enter that drawing?
No.
Neither will I.
I was not a big fan. I've never seen the series, so yeah, no, I'm not going to pay that much to enter a drawing.
Here's something that I find pretty interesting.
Before we get onto that real quick.
Yes.
I find that actually really cool that they're giving how much they're giving away with it for as much money as it is. But then on top of that, they're saying, oh, we're going to enter you into a raffle before then. And so it's like, it gives you more incentive to be like, yeah, especially those diehard fans.
Yeah, that's quite true.
So I think that's really cool, and that's something that, you know, I just find it really, really cool. I mean, granted, it's going to be released on September 29th, which is probably going to be, if you just want to wait for the Blu-ray disc and DVD combo, it's probably going to be around $40 to $50, probably.
It's never too expensive with Funimation, which is nice.
Usually, their stuff is very, very good. So what's the other thing you were talking about?
All right, so we haven't talked too much about Aniplex tonight. Mm-hmm. So I really wanted to bring this one out. Aniplex USA's Face Day Night Unlimited Blade Works Trailer Previews Dub. So, we have a bunch of new voice actors, by the way. In fact, I think 95% of the cast is replaced from the original dub. With Bryce Papenbrook replacing Sam Riegel as Shiro Emiya. And God, so many other people they have, too. The only two voice actors returning for the dub are Mela Lee as Rin Tosaka, who was Rin in both the Sentai dub and the Genion dub of Fate Stay Night, and Kerry Walgren, she reprises her roles from a Saber from the Sentai dub of Unlimited Blade Works.
Yeah.
But everyone else is replaced.
I mean, they still have a really good cast, though. They have Christina V. Stephanie Shea.
Todd Haberkorn.
Yeah, Todd Haberkorn.
Crispin Freeman. Matthew Mercer. So actually, the cast from Fate Zero are reprising their roles.
That's what I was thinking of, because I knew there was something that I thought Todd Haberkorn was in there. Crispin Freeman, I knew he was in there in one of the dubs, and that so this is going to be a done by Aniplex, not Aniplex, but this is going to be done by
Aniplex USA. Yeah, with
because
Aniplex USA
Tony
doing
Oliver
the licensing
is going to be doing the ADR directing and the script writing, so it's going to be.
And he's also Lancer.
He's also Lancer.
He also plays Lancer, which...
Does he? Wait,
surprise...
Oh, okay, there, I see his name right there. I see his name right there.
Yeah. Oddly enough, his version of Lancer is almost identical to the original Lancer.
Huh.
It's very similar. I had a hard time telling.
Wow.
Yeah, it's scary.
So, granted, that's really cool to see, I know the fact that, his dubs are going to be really, really good. A lot of stuff that he's actually directed and all that stuff have turned out really good. I think he did the Fate Stay. I think he directed, if I correct me if I'm wrong, for Fate Zero.
He did, yes. He also he was also director for Fate Zero, and there will be Aniplex of America will release the first season of Fate Stay Night Unlimited Blade Works with the English dub in a limited edition Blu-ray box set and complete first season DVD on August 25th. Both versions will include the uncut episodes 0 through 12, and will include the Japanese and English audio as well as English and Spanish subtitles. The Blu-ray disc set will include the 13 episodes on 4 discs. The limited edition Blu-ray discs will include the trailer, TV spot, commercial, and promo collection videos, Texas Open and Ending, an original soundtrack, a 24-page deluxe booklet, and an exclusive collectible Weiss Schwartz PR card while supplies last.
Yeah, but the limited edition box set, I'm looking at the price, is...
steep.
Ouch. The limited edition box set will retail for about $219. The store price will have it about $180. Now, if you want to just get it on the DVD set on 3 DVDs, we'll include the Texas openings and endings video extras. The set will retail for about $99 with a store price of $80. And I know Aniplex, this is kind of Aniplex motto. I mean,
it's a common theme from them. Yeah.
Unfortunately, that's the common thing with them, is that their stuff is really expensive.
Might as well just kick me in the nuts and call it even for me to get this damn anime now.
And you have to get kicked, like, several times.
Yeah.
You're gonna go numb. It's just...
I'm almost crying now.
Yeah.
Just thinking about it.
Unfortunately, with all these different dubs, like Fate Zero, I'd love to get Fate Zero... but it still runs into the same problem that...
Is that so expensive?
Yeah, it runs into the same problem. Like, Sword Art Online runs into that same exact problem.
$90 for 4 episodes.
Yeah. Which is something we don't normally have, especially with Funimation, and Viz usually have, a full season for, 40.
And Sentai, even though they're expensive, they're not as bad as Aniplex.
No, Aniplex is the worst. Is honestly
it literally is
the worst for having. I mean,
pricing.
Granted, their dubs when they have dubs
are phenomenal.
They're phenomenal. They're great. It's just a very steep price.
Like kicked in the nuts several times. Steep.
Yeah. Unfortunately, but hopefully, I'm really kind of hoping that they might get a little bit better. But I'm not gonna hold my breath.
Yeah, I'm not... I think it's just best to just not get your hopes up now for that kind of thing.
Actually, also, I'm going to say this right now. I'm going to actually be watching another series that started up this week. And that is... My wife is student council president. Because now it's caught my attention.
So you're going to watch it along with me.
Because I'm going to watch this
series. Other than the fact that you have to be...
Because you have to be 18 to watch it. So I'm kind of curious.
Yes.
Why?
How? I know. Why do you have to be 18 to watch this show?
Because, like, is it going to be going to where it's going to be very much so hentai?
It might have a lot of... well, it says it's going to be uncensored for premium members. So, yeah, I think it's not going to be quite the hentai-ish thing, but it's going to be...
It's going to be interesting.
Very... Yeah, oh, we're going to so be probably seeing
the,
a lot of...
So we're going to get the uncensored version, huh?
Yes.
We're lucky.
Yes. High five, Zain.
Aha.
High five. Aha!
Yeah. Oh, boy.
We did it! Kind of. Holy crap, even Jazz USA is even an Anime Expo.
Yeah, everyone's at Anime Expo this year. I mean, we're the only ones that... I feel like we're the only ones not at Anime Expo this year. The whole world at Anime Expo.
Yeah, everyone but us.
Yeah, unfortunately. So, Toei screens his first 3 World Trigger episodes with English dub. So... The English dub, actually, I don't know if they do. And this is happening, and guess where?
Anime Expo.
You got it.
Yay, what do I win?
You win the satisfaction of knowing you're not at Anime Expo.
Oh.
That's what you win.
What are you saying?
This is becoming very interesting.
It's becoming a depressing episode.
It's becoming very kind of depressing because it's like, I would love to see some of these things, but I mean, there's only so much time in a day for...
Except for the World Trigger. I'd rather not see it.
World Trigger, I think it would be interesting to see who they got to play them.
Yeah, I mean, for dubbing purposes, that's one thing, yeah. But for really the anime, I saw the first episode, I quit after 5 minutes.
I watched the first episode, I think I watched the second episode, and I just kind of petered off. Of it, so it's like, it wasn't something I really was really big into. It's just that,
I didn't like the anime style.
So, this is interesting, too. The company has not licensed the dub that Toei itself is commissioned. So, Toei is actually doing the dub.
So, Toei Animation got the people to dub the anime themselves without going through a third party like Funimation.
Yes. Or like Funimation, or Bang Zoom, or Sentai. So it's interesting to see, you know, someplace like, you know, because I would say even Animeplex does go through third parties as well, because they usually go through Bang Zoom is normal, the normal one they go through.
Yeah, because they don't have an in-house.
Yeah.
Funimation has an in-house, but they're a third-party company anyways.
Yeah. I mean, at this point in time, they're like first party.
Just about.
I mean, I feel like I have the time. But, you know, it's going to be really cool to see who they actually get, because I don't know when they were, when they're actually going to be doing that, though. I don't know when they're screening that, so I'm kind of browsing it right now. It's not saying when they're actually browsing, when it's actually going to be playing. So, I don't know. You know, when this is actually going to happen. I mean, great, if I had the thing in front of me for Anime Expo, I think it would be... Whole different story.
Grand. Yeah.
Whole different story. But, I mean, it's cool to see, you know, Anime Expo's having more and more stuff. Like, it's like, sheesh. I just feel
wishful thinking we were there.
Yeah, it really does. I'll write stuff. Or stuff right there.
Why?
Okay, so... Alright, so there's a game out coming out that Asus Games announced, third game in Zero Escape series. So American video game distributor, Asus Games, and creator,
Kotaro Uchikoshi.
I was almost there. Announced at their Anime Expo panel on Friday. will release the third game in the Zero Escape game series. The game, tentatively titled Zero Escape 3, is slated for the summer 2016, released on Nintendo 3DS and PlayStation Vita.
I'm excited.
So it's gonna be kind of cool. Which is something interesting that we can actually do with this game, though.
What?
I could get the 3DS version, you can get the Vita version, and we could see, kind of almost compare, see if they're different.
I played the second one.
Yeah.
And the second one, the Vita version, is a bit different from the 3DS version.
Yeah.
Because in the PlayStation Vita version of Volume 2, which I own and platinumed it, the thing is that the dubbing is really different.
Yeah.
Not in terms of voice acting itself, but imagine like the 3DS recoding the voice the character's mouth movements to match the lines.
Oh, okay.
And the Vita version, they did not.
Oh.
So the voice acting is a bit off from the lip syncing at times.
Oh, so the lip sync's kind of off.
Yeah. And the thing is, too, is that they weren't sure if they could even make a third game. Because it was selling so poorly in Japan, but it was selling better in the States.
Go figure. I mean, that may be the reason why it may be getting an English-only release then.
Probably, yeah.
So it wouldn't surprise me at all. But, I mean, it'd be kind of cool to see, you know, more stuff coming. Because, I mean, Persona apparently did better in the States than it did in Japan. So
50-50.
Okay, yeah. But, I mean, it's like saying the same thing with Cowboy Bebop. Cowboy Bebop did poorly in Japan, but came over to the States and did amazing.
It became a masterpiece in itself.
Yeah, so it's like...
And for good reason.
Oh, yeah, it definitely is a masterpiece. So, unfortunately, that's all the time we got left for you guys. So, thank you guys for watching. Thank you so much for your undivided attention. Definitely check out Anime Expo. If you're not at Anime Expo this year, we're sorry.
Yeah, and we'll try to keep up to date with all the news for Anime Expo, any and all announcements. Yeah.
Granted, tomorrow's really the last day for announcements. Tomorrow's really the last big day for Anime Expo. Because, I mean,
that's true.
Really, Anime Expo is the first 3 days. Yeah, there's big stuff happening in the first 2 days, and then after that, it just peters. In the fourth day, Sunday, no one's... Like, it's a calm day.
Yeah. People are just chilling. It's just Peter Griffin's downward.
Yeah, I mean, it just chills out and everything else, so... Unfortunately, Anime Expo for this year is almost over, but there's also some more cons that are coming up that are going to be just as good as Anime Expo this year,
but we'll still have really, really awesome announcements.
Yeah, so I think they'll have some really cool announcements. Granted, everyone knows that, you know, Anime Expo and Otakon are one of the two big things where people use for announcements, one of the two biggest ones people use, so...
Yeah,
so definitely keep in touch. And also, we are going to be at KomoraCon this September as well.
Yay!
What we're going to be doing there, we still have no idea. But we're going to be at KomoraCon. We're going to have lots of fun. So yeah, that's going to be from the...
It'll be on Labor Day weekend.
It's going to be on Labor Day weekend, but I'm just trying to think of the dates.
The 4th through the 7th, yes, I think.
Because it's a very weird thing, because it's like, it starts on Friday instead of Thursday, which is very weird that it goes from, like, Saturday, Sunday.
And Monday.
Yeah, and they add Monday on there, which is really weird, but I think Monday is Labor Day, though.
Yeah, Monday's Labor Day itself.
So that would make sense. That does make sense why they go that extra day.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just still very weird. Having it a 4-day con end on a Monday instead of a Sunday.
Sunday.
It's so weird. But thank you guys again for watching. So in case you guys didn't get that, we'll say it again. We're going to be at KomoraCon come the 4th through the 7th. All 4 days, we'll be there chilling out, having fun, doing whatever we do. So we're going to have more updates as time progresses. So keep a date with us. And yeah. So thank you guys again for listening. And... we'll see you guys on the flip side.
Catch you later, everybody.